varieties with some applications. And the second lecture will be on Friday. So I invite Amartya to begin his lecture.
So thank you, Professor Verma and the organizers, for sharing what would be a survey talk. And before starting the lecture, let me tell you that the purpose of the which I have in mind regarding this lecture, so that you can keep track of what is going on. So there will be three layers to this lecture. One layer is something of, let us say, history, historical evolution, which will be of historical flow of ideas, which would be of general cultural interest to all the audience, I suppose. Then there is another aspect to it, that is this concept which is mentioned in the title, G actions or locally nilpotent derivations. So these have led to major breakthroughs. And the breakthroughs, the problem is of a very simple type, that there are two rings, A and B. Are they isomorphic or not? And known methods of known invariants to distinguish between rings failed, and this G actions or locally nilpotent derivations or exponential maps, they helped in clinching the problem. Now, so this is an this is something which can be of usefulness in an unexpected way to anybody in commutative algebra, anybody who faces situations of being unable to determine whether two rings of this affine algebra type, that kx1, x2, xn mod I type rings, if they are not isomorphic, then how to show that maybe this may work. And so therefore, when people are relaxed, I mean, let us say undergraduate students or postgraduate students or PhD students, those who are bright and have extra time, they can do well to read some of these breakthroughs, so that just in case this is the thing which might help them in future, no matter in what field they are working. So that is another aspect. And the third aspect is some results of a technical nature, which would be of interest to a more limited audience who actually work in these areas, and others just listen and they may choose to forget it. So keeping this in mind, let's just look at the themes. So like today, I will not talk about G actions, because this definition, G action and exponential map, there is a bit of a mess, so I'll just postpone it for the next day. So I'll concentrate on the simpler thing of locally nilpotent derivation, which is more pleasant. And this is a case of G action, so it's not that we are talking of something else. So Hilbert's its connection with Hilbert's 14th problem and results on kernel of locally nilpotent derivation and finite generation. Now this obviously of general cultural interest. Then this breakthroughs in affine algebraic geometry using locally nilpotent derivation, the non-triviality of an important threefold called Russell-Cotes threefold, and this is something which I would suggest that all youngsters have a good look at what is going on. You never know, this may be useful to you also, even if you are not working in this so-called affine algebraic geometry. And this locally nilpotent derivation, characterization of affine spaces and Zariski cancellation problem for the plane. I'll go as far as I can today, and there is of course the next day. So this B is anyway for next day. So in commutative algebra course, one major theorem that students come across is Hilbert basis theorem. But this result comes quite late in chapter 3 or sometimes even in chapter 6 maybe. But that is really the first result in commutative algebra, the result which came up even when the subject had formally come up, when there was not even a sense that there is a subject called commutative ring theory. So how did it come up? It came up from a major problem on invariant theory in 19th century. So to put things in a simple language means for us, I'm just using the notation with which you are familiar, that let B be a polynomial ring and G be an algebraic subgroup of GLNK, the group of n cross n invertible matrices acting on B. And then let A be the subring of B, which comprises the invariant of this group action, that is all F, so that sigma of F is F for every sigma in G. So is this invariant ring finitely generated? That was the problem of invariant theory. Now you may not believe what I'm saying because you may think that this language was not there. See, what effectively it means is that just take a collection of homogeneous polynomials of a certain degree and then look at linear transformations. Then what are the expressions which are invariant under those linear transformations? So for example, the quadratic expression ax squared plus bx plus c, if you make a linear transformations, it becomes something else. But the so it becomes a dash x squared plus b dash x squared plus c dash. But this b squared minus 4ac, the discriminant, that would be same as b dash squared minus 4a dash c dash. That one can just see by plain calculations. So this, what are all the invariants? And these invariants, can they be all be expressed as polynomials in finitely many invariants? That was really their way of expressing it. And it was thought that this ring is probably finitely generated. And a major theorem in the 19th century, before Hilbert came into the picture, is by Paul Gordon. And Paul Gordon is the PhD guide of the mother of commutative algebra, Amy Noether, founder of commutative algebra, Amy Noether. Her PhD was done under Paul Gordon. And Gordon proved that yes, A is finitely generated, but for two variables and for SL2K action. And for this, he was declared the king of invariants. But note that this is ironic. His method was enormously computational, and it is enormously complicated computations. And with his methods, there was no way mathematicians were able to generalize to the higher number of variables. And then David Hilbert, 20 years later, two decades later, he came up with what you know now as Bessie's theorem, by a completely revolutionary approach to algebra, the beginning of the abstract approach that we see now. And initially his proof was existential, and there is an anecdote, which of course some historians challenge whether about its authenticity, that Gordon made a statement that this is theology, not mathematics. But Hilbert later gave constructive arguments as well, and Gordon simplified it further. And Amy Noether, I told you that Amy Noether is a PhD student. Her work was of the Gordon type to begin with, that is highly computational. But after coming in contact with Hilbert's work, she completely shifted and she became more abstract than Hilbert himself. So now, so you remember this, that Gordon proved it only for n equal to 2, and Hilbert made a massive generalization. So this is the problem, to repeat it, that we have a polynomial ring and there is a GLN, there's a group which is a subgroup of GLNK acting on the polynomial ring. A is the ring of invariants. Now Hilbert considered a large class of group actions. And the common property for all those groups that Hilbert considered was that the subring A turned out to be a graded algebra over the field K, and there happened to be a linear degree preserving retraction from B to A. So just take an example that suppose G is finite. Then in that case, you just define the retraction phi to be, look at the averaging, look at all the summation sigma f. and divided by n. And this kind of this summation sigma f you are familiar with when you look at the in your Galois theory arguments. You see that this kind of averaging, this comes up repeatedly. Anyway, so how this problem was solved? So Hilbert proved the theorem that you now know, that every ideal of the polynomial ring kx1, x2, xn is finitely yes.
But here n is the number of variables, but you want to divide by order of the group.
Yes, so there is a confusion here. So I didn't notice it, that this n, this n is not this n. So thank you very much for pointing out. This n is the cardinality of G. This one. So it should be replace n by cardinality of G. Yes, it has nothing to do with this n. Thanks. So Hilbert proved that every ideal of B is finitely generated. And why did he prove that? It was not the aim in its, that was not the aim. It was a step towards proving that this subring A is finitely generated. So how does it come about? So since there is a retraction, it is easy to see that A is a direct summand of B. And from that, it is easy to see that every ideal of A is finitely generated. In other words, in our language, A is a Noetherian ring. And then it is not hard to prove this, which can be done at MSc level. Sometimes probably it is done, that if A is a graded algebra, and if A is Noetherian, then A has to be finitely generated. So the major thing that was needed, these things are not difficult to prove. The major thing that was needed was to prove that every ideal of B is finitely generated. So that is how Hilbert basis theorem came up, not over general Noetherian ring, but over fields. So now, naturally, you know that there were extra assumptions on the group G, which led, the kind of cases. So it involved some properties of the ring A, but then there are groups, other kinds of groups as well. So the question still remains that whether the problem of invariance is true more generally, and that led Hilbert to formulate his famous 14th problem. So before I come to the statement, just notice that.
Amartya, there's one more comment from Mandira.
Yes.
For the retraction, we need to impose condition on the characteristic.
See, actually, at this, at that level, when we are talking about 19th century, things are in characteristic zero.
Right.
See, we are having a historical discussion. After all, when we are looking at 1 by n,
yeah,
obviously, I'm assuming n is not zero.
Okay.
So for historical discussions, it is characteristic zero. Yeah, so maybe one could have stated that K is a field of characteristic zero. Yeah. So just mark one thing, that A is the intersection of the polynomial ring Kx1, x2, xn with the field of fractions of A. For example, look at Kx square, x cube. That doesn't satisfy this property, that you look at the field of fractions of this, that is K round bracket X, and K round bracket X intersection K square bracket X is not this ring. I mean, it is just K square bracket X. So A satisfies this. This is something which you remember. And then you can appreciate the statement of Hilbert's 14th problem, that so take L to be a subfield of the pure transcendental extension kx1 x2 xn, and let A be kx1 x2 xn intersection L. So now you know how it came about, and so A is lying between K and kx1 x2 xn, and with the additional property that this L is the quotient field of A, or field of fractions of A. Now, is A necessarily finitely generated over K? And that is Hilbert's 14th problem. Now, you know that by that time, so this Hilbert is 1900, and in the 1920s, the Emmenoether's 20s onwards, Emmenoether's approach has come up, and which is to generalize a result or a problem to as far as possible, and thereby you get deeper insights. So Zariski naturally generalizes this problem by replacing kx1, x2, xn. After all, as you have seen from that example of kx square, x cube, things have something to do with normality. How about replacing this? So A, you know, it has to be normal. So how about replacing this by normal? Normal means integrally closed in its field of fractions. So replace kx1, x2, xn by normal affine k-domain. Then what does the problem now? The generalization of Hilbert's 14th problem by Zariski, that takes this form, that suppose K is a field and B is a normal affine K domain. L is a subfield of the field of fractions of B containing A, and A is B intersection L. So is A necessarily finitely generated over K? And Zariski had proved, given an affirmative answer, when the transcendence degree of L over K is less than or equal to 2. So that is Zariski's theorem. So in particular, it also answers Hilbert's 14th problem in the affirmative for, transcendence degree 2. Now, before proceeding further, let us fix up some notation. So one is that r to the power square n will denote a copy of the polynomial ring. In other words, A can be expressed as r t1 t2 tn, where t1 t2 tn are algebraically independent over R. Now, this has come up repeatedly in this virtual seminar, the symbolic power. So for a prime ideal P of R, P symbolic N is the power R. And for an unmixed height one ideal, unmixed means that all associated primes are of the same height. So here, all associated primes are of height one. So take I to be such a pure height one ideal, and with its associated, so R is, just assume R to be Noetherian. And suppose the associated primes are P1, P2, PR, then look at its complement. R minus P1, P2, just as here you take R minus P, here you take R minus P1, P2, PR. Then I symbolic N, this ideal was also discussed in this seminar. I symbolic N is, you look at the extension of I in S inverse R and then take the contraction. So this is just to remind you. Now, before a counterexample to Hilbert's problem, there was a counterexample to the Zariski's question. That was given by Ries, and this has also been mentioned here earlier. So let me just repeat that the coordinate ring.
Amartya, there is a clarification.
Yeah.
From Miyazaki, he says, do you mean I to the power n s to the minus 1 r?
Oh, there is a slip here. There is a typo. This is r intersection I to the power n.
Right.
Yeah, this is I to the power n. I somehow missed it. R intersection I to the power n. Sorry. Yeah, so the coordinate ring of the cone over the elliptic curve. So this is the ring. Just take this to be the ring. So this has a prime ideal P of height 1, such that you look at the direct sum of the nth symbolic powers. So this can be embedded in the polynomial ring in two variables. This was shown by Ring to be Ries. To be not finitely generated over C, and that gives a, so this A is a subring of not just, this is R is this ring, this is a normal ring. So R2, the polynomial ring R2 is a normal ring, normal affine K domain. And you have a subring here, which is not finitely generated. So incidentally, this I'm jumping this because later I may give a reference to this, that this is the example which Professor Bhatwadekar and I had used to show that there exists what is called a locally nilpotent derivation. I'll define this later, but just take it that there exists a locally nilpotent derivation on the polynomial ring Rxy, or let us say Ruv, whose kernel is isomorphic to this ring. And so in particular, there exists a locally nilpotent derivation on the polynomial ring in two variables whose kernel is not finitely generated. And this was one of the earliest examples of kernel of locally nilpotent derivation not being finitely generated. Anyway, so we'll come to that later. But that was counterexample to Zariski's question. Now let us look at counterexamples to Hilbert question. So just recall what was Hilbert's problem, that L is a subset of K round bracket x1, x2, xn, and you take the intersection of L with the polynomial ring, call that A. So A is a subring of K x1, x2, xn, with L being field of fractions. Now, if transcendence degree of L over K is less than equal to 2, then Zariski has already proved that the answer is yes. That was 1954, but shortly thereafter, Nagata had proved that in general, the answer is no. So counterexample was constructed by Nagata. So he took N to be, or in his counterexample, N was 32. And the transcendence degree was 4. So now you'd like to have lower dimensional counterexample. So although there was a counterexample, so that didn't end Hilbert's, 14th problem being a problem of interest. Then Paul Roberts significantly decreased N. In 1990, he gave a counterexample for N equal to 7 with transcendence degree 6. And then Freudenberg gave counterexample for 6, and Degle and Freudenberg together gave counterexample for 5. This comes earlier. You see the year of public. This is going by the year of publication. The result was obtained. This result was obtained earlier than this. So this is 6. Then this is 5, and then finally Kuroda gave the lowest possible dimensional because he brought it down. See, you can't go up to 2, so Kuroda to 3. Now, that is the history as far as Hilbert's 14th problem counterexample is concerned. But now I'll come to locally nilpotent derivations. Before defining it, just some kind of a motivation that it was realized Paul Roberts did not think in terms of locally nilpotent derivations, but it was realized that the ring that he constructed is the kernel of a locally nilpotent derivations on the polynomial ring in 7 variables. So here you have a situation that the example was obtained by some other means, and then later it's realized that it is actually kernel of a locally nilpotent derivations. However, the examples that Freudenberg and Degle-Freudenberg constructed, they were conscious locally nilpotent derivations. Namely, first Freudenberg took the polynomial in 6 variables and constructed a locally nilpotent derivation whose kernel is not finitely generated. And then Degle-Freudenberg did it over polynomial ring in 5 variables. So here you see that locally nilpotent derivations is used to construct low dimensional counterexamples to Hilbert's 14th problem. So now let us start the dull aspects, definitions and results. So what is a locally nilpotent derivation? So for locally nilpotent derivations, rings always contain the field of rationals. This is not just characteristic 0, it should contain Q. So I may be missing it, but for today, rings will contain Q, and next time it will be general on Friday. So derivation, you in a commutative algebra course, you know all that derivation is something, it's a map which is linear and which satisfies Leibniz's rule. And then locally nilpotent derivation is a derivation such that for each element in B, there exists such that d to the power nx is 0. And this n is dependent on x derivative. So del del x, that is a locally nilpotent derivation. And it is really a generalization. That partial derivative, it really tries to capture something. That something is caught by locally nilpotent derivations. Now, one technical result, this would be useful to appreciate certain things, that suppose D is a local nilpotent divergence on B and A is a kernel. Okay, then there exists an element, if there exists an element such that DB equal to 1, then B is a polynomial ring over A with B as a generator. So you see that one of the problems one faces is that whether B is a, you are given a ring B. This problem commutative algebraists face sometimes, that whether B is a polynomial ring over a subring. And this is generally hard, how to go about it. Now here there is a constructive way of doing it in case it works, that are you able to, I mean this is something that one can try, that are you able to construct a locally nilpotent derivations on B such that one is in its image. So this is something you can play around, and if you can hit it, fine, you are done, then B is AB. And this is a very simple result. I mean, its proof is not very complicated, but you can see that it addresses one issue which comes up, whether a ring is a polynomial ring over a subring. So in other words, this is just D over A, and yeah, so this is what I was saying, that if A is a subring of B and you want to realize whether this is a polynomial ring, you just try to check that. Now, just one motivation which was a motivation for locally nilpotent derivations in the initial years, though it has not been useful so far, but you can just to get a feel for locally nilpotent derivations, I'm mentioning it. So if suppose K is a field of characteristic zero and look at the derivation, fx, that means del f del x, fx del del y minus fy del del x. Now this one can check that this is a derivation. Now you know that one of the most famous conjectures in algebra is a Jacobian conjecture. So just as you had 23 problems of Hilbert, there are 18 problems of Smell, Fields Medalist, for the 21st century, and Jacobian conjecture is one of the 18 problems. So Jacobian conjecture can be stated like this, that if del f g equal to 1, that means if there exists a g so that fx gy minus fy gx is 1, then f and g are a pair of coordinates for kxy. Kxy is equal to kfg. Now, by Slice theorem that I just now mentioned, this Jacobian conjecture can be stated equivalently, that if one is in the image, because you see, after all, now this is a question of that whether kxy is a polynomial ring over kf. F is given to me. So you see, in the normal statement of Jacobian conjecture, you have two elements, f and g. But here, we can make it as a statement of one element, f. That question is that whether kxy is a polynomial ring over kf. So it can be put like this, that you see that G is not being mentioned. If one is in the image of delta F, then delta F is an LND. So the whole point is that this is a derivation. Can you show it's a locally nilpotent derivation? It sounds so simple. So you can see that this concept of locally nilpotent derivation, it has its usefulness. That Jacobian conjecture can put it in this language, though this putting hasn't helped. That's another matter. Now, so that is all about Jacobian conjecture. Now, before going into the next page, let me define something, that is the concept of inert subring. So if D is a locally nilpotent derivation with kernel A, then A is an inert subring of B. This is another property of kernel of locally nilpotent derivation. Kernel of locally nilpotent derivation is an inert subring. That means, what is an inert subring? If for x and y in B, the product xy is in A, then both factors x and y will be in A. So as a consequence, in particular, if K is a field of fractions of A, then you can clearly see from this that A will be intersection of B and K. So therefore, you have a special case of Hilbert's 14th problem. That now let us restrict to of so D is a locally important derivation, A is kernel of D, and this is you have this is A necessarily finitely generated over K. So this is Hilbert's 14th problem with the addition that A is realized as the kernel of LND on KX1, X2, XN. Now when Professor JKV first approached me, he had suggested to give some talk where there would be a result of Professor Seshadri. And you see, Professor Seshadri had a result in 1962 that if dV is contained in V, so let V be the direct sum of the coordinates, kx1, x, direct sum kx2, kxn. Now, if your locally important derivation is such that this thing is retained, dV is contained in V, then Seshadri had proved that A is finitely generated over K. This was 1962. Of course, there are names before that. This just means that they had this result. But you know, from the year, you can guess that their results, I mean, their proofs will have gaps or incomplete arguments at such an early stage. So this result was realized, but a real formal proof, completely satisfactory proof, was given first time by Seshadri. Okay. So now let us quickly come to the role of local important derivations in Hilbert's 14th problem. Or what is happening with this version of Hilbert's 14th problem. So the question is A finitely generated over K? So this is nothing new. I mean, just what was shown in the previous slides. So what is the answer? The answer is positive if n is less than or equal to 3. And not only positive, the A turns out to be a polynomial ring. In the case of n equal to 2, you see, transcendence degree of, the kernel will have transcendence degree 1 less than the original ring. So when n equal to 2, A will be polynomial in one variables. And when n equal to 3, I think something is missing. See, D, I forgot to write, D is non-zero. That's a blanket assumption. Sometimes there will be some such slips. D is not zero. Assume that. So when n equal to 2, A is polynomial ring in one variable. And when n equal to 3, A is a polynomial ring in two variables. So this is classical with respect to this area. And this is a major theorem of Miyanishi, that A is polynomial ring in two variables. However, if n greater than or equal to 5, then A need not be finitely generated. So this was first shown for that for n greater than or equal to 7, this was shown by S.N. Janssen, using the example of Paul Roberts, which I had mentioned earlier, Paul Roberts' counterexample to Hilbert's 14th problem. And then I had mentioned Freudenberg already. Freudenberg and Degle-Freudenberg, they had proved that for n equal to 6 and n equal to 5, this is not so. However, the problem is open for n equal to 4. And this is one of the central problems now in affine algebraic geometry, that for n equal to 4, is A necessarily finitely generated over K? So this is an open problem related to Hilbert, or open problem, which is a special case of Hilbert's 14th problem. So what is known about this problem, that for N equal to 4? So now N is restricted to 4. A kernel. Is A necessarily finitely generated over K? So I said it's an open problem. So now what you expect from me is just partial results. Thing which Degle and Freudenberg had shown is that the number of generators there is no bound on the number of generators. In other words, you give me an integer R, then a locally nilpotent derivation can be constructed whose kernel requires more than R generators. So therefore, there is no statement that A must be generated, can be generated by at most four elements or five elements. You cannot have any such statement. And one special case was proved by Bhatwadekar and Degle, that this X1 is just for simplicity of writing. The X1 just means one of the coordinates, any variable. So if you can catch hold of a variable, a coordinate of kx1, x2, x3, x4, such that its derivative is zero, then A is finitely generated. Actually, you know what? That this was transformed into a problem about that. You see, if x, you look at kx1, kx1 is a PID, and dx1 equal to zero means that if you think of it as R x2, x3, x4, that means a polynomial ring in three variables over the PID R. And then you have a locally nilpotent derivations which fixes R, because you know dx1 equal to zero, so R is fixed. So an R derivation of R xyz. So that is what they had considered. They had studied the locally nilpotent derivations of R xyz, where R is a more generally Dedekind domain. And so as a particular case, they answered this for dx1 equal to zero. So now that will raise a question. Just suppose you put this additional assumption that dx equal to zero for some variable x. So for my writing convenience, just let us call that x to be x1. So suppose dx1 is zero, then Bhatwadekar Degle has have already proved that A is finitely generated. Now let us get more ambitions. You remember that when N is less than or equal to 3, then by Rentschler and Miyanishi, A will actually be a polynomial ring. So can you, for N equal to 4 in this case, can you show that A is a polynomial ring? And there are very interesting answers. Like there is a three authors, Bhatwadekar, Nina and Swapnil, they have proved that if A is a regular ring, that if the kernel is a regular ring, then yes, A becomes a polynomial ring. And more recently, Nina and Nikhilesh, they have proved that what they call nice derivations. That means that dx1 is zero, and in addition, assume that d square is zero for all the variables. So these are called nice derivations. So though, so for that, in that case, A is a polynomial ring. So these are some partial results. Now, so another direction in which one can look at this Hilbert-Zariski problem, generalizing Hilbert-Zariski problem, is that so far we were talking about K, that let K be a field. And you know the heart's desire of commutative algebra is to address questions over the most general rings possible, most general Noetherian, if not Noetherian, at least UFD normal and so on. So you look at this problem that now replace K by R. Suppose R is not, suppose A is between R and Rx. Is A necessarily a finitely generated R algebra? So you can look at it, the genesis, from two directions. One is the Hilbert-Zariski, and the other is that Luderth analog. You can think of it that, you know, Luderth had proved that K round bracket X, you look at K round bracket X, then any subfield is of the form K Fx, is singly generated. So how far you have the analog? So first is A finitely generated? Now this is, yes, if R is a field, that means if it is K, A and KX, then A is finitely generated. This is a very interesting exercise in a first course in commutative algebra for integral extension. Those who have done integral extensions And of course, Noetherian modules and Noetherian and integral, if these two chapters are done, then this would be a very good exercise. And you can see from these examples that if you replace K by even a PID like KY, this is, what better can you take? Then very easily you can see that this is not true. So next question is that can you put conditions when A is necessarily a finitely generated algebra? So after field or PID, the next thing that one explores is UFD. And in the case of UFD, you actually have a Lüderth analog, not just finitely generated, it is actually a polynomial ring. This is a very old result of Abhyankar, Ikin, Heinzer. So let me repeat, R is a UFD, A is a UFD. So Rx is of course a UFD. In that case, A is necessarily a polynomial ring. And this is a very useful result. Proof is not very long. I mean, it's tricky, but it's just like a one-page proof. And a very useful result, but surprisingly, it's not very well known. What is it I want to say? Now, so after that, you would like to relax. Okay, let fix R to be a UFD or even PID, but A UFD, if you want to relax, then first is that Ikin gives an example that even over CT and A Noetherian, you don't have the result. I mean, you have counter example. However, this is interesting that that problem is with CT that this is not complete. If the ring is complete, so for simplicity, I'm putting it as C power series tree. It is actually a one-dimensional complete DVR whose residue field is algebraically closed. In fact, even it would have to take. So A equal to, so just to fix ideas, let us take this. And if A is Noetherian, then indeed A is finitely generated. This is something which I had proved with Professor Onoda. And then you would ask, from one variable, you would like to obviously, so the key word is complete, that if you want this Lüderth type statement or Hilbert-Zariski type of result, then you start with a complete base ring. So next is complete regular ring of dimension 2. And then you try to put as many good conditions as possible. Noetherian, normal, of course, short of UFD, because in UFD you already have a theorem, even flatness, all this together doesn't show that A is finitely generated. But under an additional fiber condition, A will turn out to be finitely generated. But this, since this is nothing to do with GA actions, I'll close the topic here, that I won't tell you what exactly the result is. This can be an independent result. So now I'll talk about another result of a general type where you are talking about RC. Here, if you notice that we are not mentioning LND, we just straight away went back to the original Hilbert, Zariski or Lüderth, but now let us bring in LND into the picture. So suppose now you just take two variables and D is an LND, A is a kernel. So what is the structure of A? Is it necessarily finitely generated? If R is a UFD, then from the result of Abhyankar, Ikin, Heinzer, it easily follows that A is a polynomial ring because that inert subring always. And because it is an inert subring, A is a UFD because it's an inert subring of a UFD. Inert subring of a UFD is a UFD. This result is quite old and it can be checked easily. I mean, you don't have to read a paper, you can fix it yourself. That in inert subring of a UFD is a UFD. So therefore, you have R is a UFD and A is a UFD. Then by Abhyankar, Ikin, Heinzer, A is a polynomial ring. So the real difficulty comes up when R is normal. And here, the previous lectures on symbolic powers, that would be of help. So if R is normal, then Bhattwadekar and I had proved that there exists an unmixed ideal unmixed height one ideal such that the kernel is isomorphic to this quantity I symbolic n t to the power n direct sum. So this is one. So said that what is the structure of A? If R is normal, it's the sum of I symbolic n t to the power n. Now conversely, this is its converse is also true. That is, now forget whatever is written here. Start with an unmixed height one ideal. Start with an unmixed height one ideal of a Noetherian normal domain R. R is normal, that is given. Noetherian domain is given. So R is a Noetherian normal domain. R is an unmixed height one ideal. Then there exists a kernel. There exists a locally nilpotent derivation whose kernel is isomorphic to this quantity. So therefore,
there is a question.
Yes.
The D that you are considering here, is it R derivation?
Yes. Certainly. Yes.
Okay.
D okay. is an D fixes R.
Okay.
Thank you. I think such questions are very much welcome. So I go back to what I was mentioning, that there was a counter example of Ries. I mentioned the first counter example to use Zariski's problem, and using that example and this result, you can see that there exists, because you know by Ries you have a prime ideal P such that this is not finitely generated. I am say, and we have showed that there exists local nilpotent derivations whose kernel. So from this theorem and Ries's example, you have that for this ring elliptic curve there exists LND such that kernel is not finitely generated. Okay, so now we one chapter is closed, the Hilbert's 14th problem. Now we move on to something else. The point I was trying to say that how locally nilpotent derivations can be used to prove that two rings are not isomorphic. So this is something which Nina had already talked about, but let me repeat that. Look at this ring A. This was constructed by Russell and Corus in the connection with linearization conjecture. Now it was a very important question, a very hot topic at that time, that whether this ring is a polynomial ring in three variables over C. And it was believed that it is so. I mean, the what you call the trend was this. If your betting had been taken, then it would be taken in favor of this. Why? Because all things were favorable. A is smooth, A is a UFD. So if A is a polynomial ring, then what are the things you would expect? So known invariants, they were all being satisfied. A is smooth, A is UFD, A star is C star. So there is a injection from C3 to A, and there is an injection from A to C3. So if A is isomorphic to C3, you have this, and those things are satisfied. So if A is a polynomial ring, by Quillen-Suslin theorem, all projective A modules are free. And that independently has been seen here, that all projective modules are free. And then geometrically or topologically, you see that V is, that is, you look at the zero set, that is diffeomorphic to RC. Of course, here I'm cheating a little bit, that diffeomorphism was proved a little later, but it was shown to be, little less than diffeomorphic, that was known. Now, so that thing that this would lead to A is C3, because C.P. Ramanujam, one of his beautiful theorems on topological characterization of the affine plane, was that every normal affine surface homeomorphic to C2 must be C2. And incidentally, this Ramanujam proved this theorem in an attempt to solve the Zariski cancellation problem for the plane. This is a Zariski cancellation problem, that if B1 is K3, is B K2? So in order to prove that, it would be good to know characterization of B. And so Ramanujam came up with this characterization But of course, he could not complete the proof. I mean, he proved this theorem, but not this theorem. This was eventually proved by Miyanishi, Fuji, and Sujai. And later, Professor Gurjar had given a topological proof along the lines that Ramanujam attempted, but that came later. Now, to look at the importance of the Russell-Cotes threefold, that what would be the consequence of it? I mean, assuming that we still don't know what is the answer. So if A is not isomorphic to the polynomial ring, which seemed unlikely, then it will be a step towards proving the linearization conjecture for C3, because already much work was done for the linearization conjecture. So if A not equal to C3, and there were some other threefolds of the Russell-Cotes type, if all are proved. But if A is C3, which is most likely, then it will be a counterexample to linearization conjecture, whatever the linear conjecture is. Let us not be distracted by that. And more importantly, it would be, and significantly, it would be a counterexample to the Abhyankar-Sathe conjecture. It's a very formidable conjecture, very easy to state. Cxyz modulo f, if it is isomorphic to the polynomial ring in two variables, then is f a coordinate in Cxyz? So conjecture is it is. Now, why this would be a counterexample? Because you look at the image of capital X, call it small x. Then for any non-zero lambda, A modulo x minus lambda C2, that you can take it easily, that you just put x equal to lambda. If you put x equal to lambda, then this is just like y plus something. So it is clearly this should be wait a minute, what is happening? A mod, this is three variables. Yeah, so this is C2. However, A mod X, so go modulo X, then what you get is Z squared plus T cube. So this is not even regular. There's no question of this becoming C2. So therefore, A cannot be, so X minus lambda, so A not equal to Cx, so X minus lambda, therefore, since X is not plane, so X minus, or X is not a hypersurface, so therefore X minus lambda cannot be a coordinate. So you have this, A mod X minus lambda is C2, but A not equal to Cx minus lambda 2. So that will be a counterexample to Abhyankar-Sathe conjecture, provided A is proved to be C3, which seemed to be likely the case. However, Makar-Limanov proved that A is not equal to C3. So this was a major triumph of the tool of local nilpotent derivations or GA actions that nothing else could distinguish. When nothing else was able to distinguish the two rings, they did it. So there's still 5 minutes, I suppose. So let me define what is a Makar-Limanov invariant. So it involved the invariant. So to distinguish between rings, Makar-Limanov introduced to a ring R the algebraic invariant, that is intersection of all kernels of local nilpotent derivations. So look at all the kernels. So later, when we talk about exponential maps, so mostly Makar-Limanov, but later when exponential maps came up, which we'll see next time, it will be intersection of the exponential maps or intersection of the G actions. So he named it, because the terminology is significant, he named it the ring of absolute constants. So you see, local nilpotent derivation being zero means that it is something like those things which are zero, they can be thought of as a constant, but that is with respect to a particular LND. But if something is constant with respect to every LND, then you call it absolute constant. So he called it AK invariant, very nice name. But later in his honor, it is now named Makar-Limanov invariant. So let us look at an example. So what is a Makar-Limanov invariant of Cxyz? So suppose f belongs to the Mach-Lehmanov invariant of C is it. That means that df equal to zero for every t. So in particular, every of course non-zero d. So in particular, del f del x is zero, del f del y is zero, and del f del f z is zero. And you know, if all the partial derivatives are zero, then f must be a constant. So you see, f is what is what he called absolute constant. So Mach-Lehmanov invariant of CXYZ is C. I mean, it applies to any polynomial ring. So how Mach-Lehmanov invariant solves the open problem? Now you see, it is so, the idea of the proof is so ingeniously simple. You don't need heavy machinery or anything. This definition is just two lines. You have to just local important derivation definitions in one line, Mach-Lehmanov one line, and maybe you have to know a few properties. That's all. So Mach-Lehmanov theorem is you prove this. Now so you let this, let x be this. Now it is easy to see that x is not a constant. The image of x here is not a constant, that you can see, or at least you can believe. Now what Mach-Lehmanov proved was, now this is just elementary calculation. Point is that this doesn't require any machinery. This requires some work, but it is elementary work, meaning it is something like the kind of skill you needed in higher secondary. So he showed that if d is a local nilpotent derivation, then d of x has to be zero. That is the work that he did. And therefore, Mach-Lehmanov A cannot be C, because x is in Mach-Lehmanov invariant of A and x is outside C. But on the other hand, just now I have shown you that ML Mach-Lehmanov invariant of C3 is C. So therefore, Mach-Lehmanov invariant of A and Mach-Lehmanov invariant of C3 are not same. Therefore, A is not same as C3. Now you just see how astonishingly simple the proof turned out to be. I mean, of course, there is some work with, to be done here, but that work is elementary. I don't mean it is easy, but it is elementary. So this is something which is worth studying for every student, because I mean, by, you know, fiddling around, you may be, if by chance you are in a ring which are not isomorphic and their Mach-Lehmanov things are not same, and if you can show that, I mean, so this I would strongly advertise that this thing. Maybe I can just get into one more page today, that application to linearization. Yeah, so this will complete the story. That linearization conjecture, now I'm saying formally, every faithful algebraic K-star action on Kn is linearizable. That's a linearization conjecture. So in the language of commutative rings, it means that for any Z-graded structure of the ring Kx1, x2, xn, there exists a set of variables in Kx1, x2, xn, which is homogeneous with respect to the Z-grading. Now it's a classical, I mean, it was known that it is true for n less than equal to 2. So the problem starts with n equal to 3, and naturally with characteristic 0 and algebraically closed field. So the first question is C star action on C3 linearizable? Which this is the problem which I was discussing. So to summarize what I was telling you, that after the work of Russell Corus on the question, Russell Corus had worked on it. So there was a remaining step. So they had constructed a family of hypersurfaces in C4. And the simplest example is what I had showed. And they showed that, and they the question was whether this family is isomorphic to C3. Each member of this family is isomorphic to C3. If not, then the proof would be completed. But if any such surface is C3, then that would be a counterexample. So if any such surface is C3, then it is a counterexample. And if none is C3, then it will complete the proof. So things was there. So first, Mach-Lehmanov proved that the example which I demonstrated, that is not isomorphic to C3. And later, Makalimenov and Kaliman, by the same techniques, they disposed of all the Russell-Korus threefolds. None of them are isomorphic to C3. And so that completes the proof of the linearization conjecture, I mean, now theorem, that any faithful algebraic sister action on C3 is linearizable. So you can consider it as a joint work of Russell-Korus, Makalimenov. So I think this is a good time to stop. And so next we'll talk about the characterization of the plane and the three space. So we'll start from here tomorrow, I mean on Friday.
Thank you very much, Amartya, for a very interesting talk. We open for questions now.
As I said, partial reference, because very recent results will not occur here. A partial reference for the concept of locally nilpotent derivations, excellent monograph is Freudenberg's book, G. Freudenberg. You have seen his name occurring in the slides. Algebraic theory of locally nilpotent derivations. So there is a second edition. You should look at that, because the first edition, 2006, many problems there were solved later, and many results were not included in the earlier, which is now included. So this is a book which would be a reference for this, partial reference. Yeah.
So there's a question from Parnashri Ghosh. Maybe Parnashri can ask the question. Can you open your mic and ask the question? Go to the last slide.
This one?
Yeah.
Hello?
Yes.
Please ask. Sir, I just wanted to take a snap. That's all.
No, we will make the slides available on the website.
Okay.
Okay, any other questions?
I have a small comment to make.
Yes.
So regarding the question that whether an R subalgebra of Rx is finitely generated or not over R, I think that's true if and only if R is a finite product of fields.
What?
If and only if R is a finite product of fields.
I'd shown an example, right? What about this?
No, I am saying R is a finite product of fields.
So actually, no, what?
But you are saying if and only if, right?
Yes.
So
I am saying that whenever R is not a finite product of fields, you can always construct an R. Sorry, you can always construct an A between R and Rx, which is not finitely generated over R.
This is Sagnik's new result, which he has proved. In a way, it's a converse of what we say that from K to Kx.
Yes, I mean, for K to Kx, you can slightly generalize it for finite product of fields. Mm-hmm. Sorry, finite product of fields.
And converse is also true. If for every subring is finitely generated, then R must
then
be
finite product of fields.
Yeah, Amartya, I have a question about you mentioned that the kernel of a locally nilpotent derivation is symbolic Riesz algebra of a height one unmixed ideal in one situation where it was polynomial ring in two variables over a subring. Can you show that slide? I think. Did we lose connection with Amartya?
I don't see slides.
Yeah, I think he has lost connection. Anyway, Nina is here, she may know the answer.
Can you repeat
the
question?
What is the question, sir?
The question is, there was a situation where the kernel of a locally independent derivation was symbolic reasoning of a height one ideal.
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So suppose I have polynomial ring in three variables.
Polynomial ring in three variables, yes.
Over a field.
Mm-hmm.
And take a prime ideal of height two.
Mm-hmm.
And take the symbolic reasoning.
So you have kx, y, z and the symbolic Ries ring of prime ideal P.
I two prime ideal.
Okay.
Can it be realized as kernel of a LND?
No, by Mianisch's theorem, for kx, y, z, the kernel is always a polynomial ring.
So the symbolic Ries ring will not be realized.
If the symbolic Ries ring is a polynomial ring, then yes.
Yeah, which maybe is almost never.
Almost never. So that is precisely the. So yes. For Mianisch, this is a big theorem. Means actually, I would like to see an algebraic proof of that. But the proof is little of a bit of geometry. Yes. Some affine configurations which he uses. Basically, yes. Those Ithaca's kind of affine algebraic geometry which he uses. So logarithm, order, dimension, and dot dot dot.
Yeah.
Sorry, I got
lost connection.
Yes. Sorry.
Yeah, my question is answered by Nina. That take symbolic reasoning of a height two prime ideal in polynomial ring in three variables over a field. It will perhaps never be kernel of an LND by theorem of Mianisch. See, these rings, one can find height 2 prime. This is a result of Watanabe, Goto, and forget the third author, that one can find a height 2 prime in polynomial ring in three variables over a field, so that the symbolic Ries ring of that prime ideal is not finitely generated.
Yeah.
So whether that infinite generation is due to some locally independent derivation.
But
that proof is quite hard.
Mm-hmm.
But people who are working in symbolic powers of prime ideals, I have seen that many of them don't use LNDs at all.
Sir, can you share the reference of Watanabe?
Yeah, I will send you a link. Yeah, so it's a height two prime ideal. It's actually defining ideal of a monomial space curve.
Mm-hmm.
And its symbolic Ries algebra is not finitely generated. Proof involves many techniques.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Actually, I think the Roberts example was also something like symbolic Ries. No, it was P, PN, right?
Yeah, in seven variables.
That was in seven variables.
Yeah, but you know, this was Kaushik's original question about finite generation of symbolic Ries ring was for monomial, the prime ideals which are defining ideals of monomial space curve.
Mm-hmm.
So that was solved by Watanabe and others. They produced a monomial space, in fact, an infinite family of monomial space curves, so that the symbolic reasoning of their defining prime ideals are not Noetherian.
There's a reference given by Claire in the chat. Non-Cohen may call it symbolic blow-ups for space monomial curves and counterexamples to Kaushik's question by Goto, right. Nishida and Watanabe.
Right. This, they never use any LND or they basically rely on local cohomology techniques. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But it is in characteristic P.
Oh, that example is in characteristic
P. Right.
I suppose there is one very interesting question. That one doesn't know a counterexample to the Hilbert's 14th problem in positive characteristic. Mm. I suppose there is no such development. In fact, in 2014, when I was visiting Japan, there was a lot of enthusiasm because there was a paper in archive which claimed that there is a counterexample. But we could show that the paper has a flaw. So I don't know. Till date, I don't think there is an example in positive characteristic, a counterexample to the Hilbert's 14th problem.
Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah, there are many interesting questions one can look
at. Okay. Any other questions? So I don't see further questions, and so thank you again, Amartya, for your very interesting, informative talk. We will meet on Friday for the second part. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Good talk, Amartya.
Oh, where are you?
Hiding somewhere.
Okay.
I don't want to become an L&D.
excuse me, sir. May I ask you one question?
Sure.
Sir, actually, Professor Nina Gupta just said that the proof of Miani, where he proved that C3 mod GI is C2. So in that proof, he actually used the topological machineries.
Mm-hmm.
So I believe the result was only for the complex number then. So not for any characteristic zero field, right?
No. See, once some result is proved over complex, we can deduce it to characteristic zero. Means there are some Lefschetz principles and all that.
Okay. So there is some kind of Kambayashi's result.
Kambayashi and Lefschetz principle, we can bring down to characteristic zero.
Oh.
Yeah. I mean, this is explained in Artin's algebra book.
Artin's
algebra book, where he explains you prove something for C, there is a way to get it for characteristic zero.
Yeah.
Algebraically closed. Mm-hmm.
Algebraically closed, okay.
Yeah, okay. Thanks.
Okay, so maybe we can close the meeting today, and we shall meet.